Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 7602 in the name of Kenneth Gibson on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee on Scottish Budget 2023-24. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Kenneth Gibson to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Around 12 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open this afternoon's debate on pre-budget scrutiny on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The inclusion of this debate in the overall budget process was recommended by the Budget Process Review Group in 2017, with the aim of bringing greater transparency, influence and scrutiny to Scottish Government budget proposals. The debate also provides a welcome opportunity for conveners to set out how their committees have sought to influence the Scottish budget through their pre-budget reports, and for Scottish ministers to respond. That's why I'm delighted to see so many committee conveners participating in today's debate, and I look forward to listening to the contributions, as well as those of committee and other colleagues. I won't touch on all our pre-budget deliberations, as, in closing, Deputy Convener Daniel Johnson will cover what I omit. This year, the FPA committee agreed to use the Scottish Government's Resource Spending Review, published in May, to inform a pre-budget scrutiny. That review set out spending plans for the remainder of the parliamentary term, supporting the Scottish Government's ambitions from 2023-24 to 2026-27. While not intended to provide fixed budgets, the review does provide a clearer idea of the direction of travel for public finances, including public sector funding. We focused our pre-budget scrutiny primarily on three spending review areas: the impact of the cost of living crisis on the Scottish Budget 23-24, proposals for public service reform, and how spending priorities might affect the delivery of national outcomes in the National Performance Framework. Our scrutiny was also informed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission's Economic and Fiscal Forecast for Scotland and the Scottish Government's Medium-Term Financial Strategy, published alongside the Resource Spending Review in May this year. We thank our adviser, Professor Mary Spowage, for her invaluable advice throughout the year. And we are also grateful to all those who responded to our call for views, which ran between June and August, and to our witnesses for their evidence, which has helped shape our findings. However, with some notable exceptions, witnesses continue to emphasise the need for increased spending in their own portfolio areas and are reluctant to provide suggestions of where funding might be deprioritised, where additional revenue could be raised and what spending priorities should be. There's more often a willingness to assert that increased funding for their own budget area in the short term will lead to longer-term savings elsewhere in the future. Pre-budget scrutiny came at a time when the cost of essential items such as food and energy was increasing faster than incomes and inflation to reach a high, the highest for some 40 years. The Scottish Fiscal Commission's May forecast stated that the Russian invasion of Ukraine, steeply rising energy prices and further global supply chain disruptions in China have led to a challenging economic outlook. The UK faces the biggest annual fall in living standards since equivalent records began, 7.1% by the end of next year, according to the Office for Budget Responsibility. And just before we published our pre-budget report at the start of November, a third UK Prime Minister in as many months took office and serious concerns were emerging in relation to UK economic stability. In fact, economists and commentators had already spoken of the UK having entered recession. In its 2023 budget, the Scottish Government made a series of savings in year to identify allocations that could be used to fund cost of living support, including improved public sector pay offers. We heard in evidence from the Deputy First Minister last week that uncertainties remain on how it will balance the books for this financial year, with a sum of between £200 and £500 million still to be found. It's concerning that there is still this level of uncertainty so late in the financial year, and any further information that ministers can provide today will be welcome. The committee also notes Scottish Government expectations that will not be in a position to carry over any resource into 23-24, placing additional pressures on public finances next year. We heard evidence that the cost of living crisis was impacting people from across society, from businesses to households, to voluntary bodies, to communities. In our pre-budget report, we welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to provide immediate support to those most in need. We are concerned about inflationary pressures persisting into next financial year and ask the Scottish Government to look further ahead at how immediate fixes over this winter might be expended into its budget for 23-24. Responding, ministers pointed to the uprating of devolved benefits, including the early uprating and expansion of the Scottish Child Payment, continuing the Fuel and Security Fund, and doubling the Scottish Child Bridging Payment, as ways it would continue to support people through the cost of living crisis into 2023-24. We heard compelling evidence that this crisis was having a disproportionate impact on women and asked how the Scottish Government could best support women through these challenging times. We also urged the ministers to put in place robust and transparent processes to evaluate all policies and outcomes for their gender impact. This, we hoped, would better support committees in policy scrutiny decisions for their potential impact on women, including through evidence gathering. In its response, the Scottish Government said it was committed to mitigating the disproportionate impact of the cost of living crisis on women. It also accepted the principle of integrating intersectional gender analysis into its policy making, and it's taking this forward as part of its wider work on equality and human rights budgeting. We've asked in a budget report for more details on exactly how this is being taken forward. During pre-budget scrutiny, we had different views on whether the Scottish Government should, in its 2023-24 budget, follow or diverge from the UK Government's income tax policy. We explored in more detail the Scottish Government's income tax plans for the next year and a budget report published yesterday, including the potential for negative behavioural impacts reducing revenue, as highlighted by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Where we continue to find common ground is on the need to increase productivity, wage growth and labour market participation in Scotland to bolster sustainable economic growth, including growing the tax base, and also the need for greater research and development investment and indeed support for innovation. These issues are of particular interest to the committee and ones which we continue to raise as part of our wider work, including in our forthcoming scrutiny of the Scottish Fiscal Commission's first sustainability report, which will be published in March. The Scottish Government has pointed to its national strategy for economic transformation as a stimulus for addressing inactivity, low productivity and slow wage growth, and we continue to seek more details of how it will do this, along with information on how budgetary pressures will impact on delivery. The decision to cut employability services in year during 2022-23 was a particular concern to the committee, albeit we recognised that this was just one of many difficult decisions having to be taken in order to fund public sector pay deals and address the cost of living crisis. We asked the Scottish Government for the analysis it had undertaken on the reduction in funding for employability services to understand any adverse impact, including its ability to meet child poverty targets, and indeed I also raised this directly with the First Minister at the Conveners Committee in September. We thank the Deputy First Minister for the assessments carried out and welcome the rise in employability funding in 2023-24. A significant focus of the resource spending review was on public service reform. The review was intended to provide, and I quote, fresh vision for our public services reform programme and set out a coherent package of action that will drive progress over the life of the current Parliament, improving outcomes while driving efficiency and value for money. These proposals also formed a significant element of our own pre-budget scrutiny, and we asked stakeholders to provide their views on the Government's proposals to achieve reform through digitalisation, maximising revenue through public sector innovation, reform of the public sector estate, reform of the public body landscape, and improving public procurement. We noted in a pre-budget report that reform and efficiencies often require expenditure up front and time to deliver, inviting the Government to confirm whether its plans to achieve savings by the end of the parliamentary session are realistic. The limited information provided in the Scottish Government's response did not give us sufficient confidence that its plans are achievable within this timeframe. The Resource Spending Review committed the Scottish Government to publishing initial outcomes and plans for their public service reform programme alongside the Scottish Budget. In our pre-budget report, we asked that ministers develop detailed and transparent proposals clearly setting out priorities, funding, timescales and intended outcomes, as well as the potential impact on service delivery. Unfortunately, expected outcomes and reform plans were not published with the budget, and there was no explanation for this other than the suggestion that work is ongoing. As such, officials are engaging with public bodies to initiate action in identifying opportunities to reduce overhead costs, such as rationalisation of estates and public bodies. We recorded our concern about this approach in our budget report and sought further detail to provide us with the assurances we need that this work is on track and will improve public service effectiveness. We recognise the challenges faced by the Scottish Government in identifying additional money to fund public sector pay rises in response to inflation. The committee noted in our pre-budget report that the Scottish Government is seeking to reduce the public sector headcount over the rest of the parliamentary session to pre-COVID levels. So from around 447,000 to around 417,000. The First Minister's commitment to a policy of no compulsory redundancies with regard to this is welcome. And we recognise this is an uncertain time for all concerned and ask for assurances that the Scottish Government will take a partnership approach with the workforce and be open and transparent on these difficult issues. We further sought assurances that ministers will approach reducing the public sector headcount in a systematic, transparent and coordinated way in tandem with the public service reform agenda while minimising adverse effects on public service delivery. In response, the Scottish Government said it has developed its proposition around targeted workforce growth in priority areas than it is for individual public bodies to determine locally the target operating model for their workforce. Again, we believe more information is required. We continue to pursue progress with public service reform, pay and headcount in our budget report and look forward to receiving more information from the Scottish Government on these issues in due course. Finally, I want to return to where I started my speech, the resource spending review. At the time it was published, the committee welcomed the certainty and transparency it provides in relation to expected spending in future years, albeit some of the decisions that would have to be taken in delivering that report would have been very challenging. But as acknowledged by the Deputy First Minister in recent evidence to the committee, Scotland's economic and financial circumstances have changed dramatically since May. We therefore urge the Scottish Government to provide an update as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, I now look forward to hearing colleagues' contributions and I'm pleased to move motion S6M07602 in my name that the Parliament notes the pre-budget scrutiny undertaken by the Finance and Public Administration Committee and other parliamentary committees.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Gibson. Before calling the Cabinet Secretary, could I just add a gentle reminder to those who haven't already pressed their request to speak buttons and are wanting to speak in the debate to do so as soon as possible. Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate is an important part of Parliament's scrutiny of the Scottish Budget and I appreciate the engagement across committees in the preparation for this debate. This has been a particularly challenging budget to develop. The war in Ukraine, the surge in inflation, the damage to the public finances done by the mini-budget in September all create an exceptionally difficult landscape in which to develop and bring forward the Scottish Budget. We have had to make, as a government, difficult choices, and Parliament will have to consider and determine those choices in the course of the next few weeks. A balance has to be struck between the funding available and what that can deliver for the people of Scotland. We have actively chosen to increase the funding available to the Scottish Budget through our fair and progressive approach to taxation. We have brought to Parliament a budget that sets a different path for Scotland. It is a path that prioritises the elimination of child poverty, the transition to net zero, and the sustainability and effectiveness of our public services. The Public Finance and Administration Committee report recognises the nature and the scale of the financial challenges that we continue to grapple with in the current financial year and which set a very challenging context for the year ahead. As I made clear in my evidence to the committee earlier this month, and I take seriously the points made by the convener of the Finance Committee in his comments about the committee's report about the undesirability of there not being a path to balance the budget at this stage in the year, I can assure Parliament that is not for the want of trying, and it's a measure of the scale of the challenge that we face because of the factors that I recounted earlier on in my speech. But I assure Parliament that we are working to address these issues in the time available to us. We have, of course, limited fiscal powers, so we have had no option but to reduce our spending in order to meet the pressures on our budget, not least of which is the £700 million of additional funding that we have allocated for public sector pay, which of course makes a substantial contribution to assisting members of the public who are public sector employees in dealing with the cost of living crisis that we face. We recognise that public sector pay is an important issue to Parliament. I explained in my budget statement that I was not publishing a public sector pay policy because of the uncertainty over the outlook for inflation and the need to conclude some pay deals in the current year. We can still make progress on pay discussions for 23-24. Indeed, the Scottish Government is continuing to engage on pay issues with trade unions and public sector employers, and I personally, along with the Health Secretary, have been actively involved in negotiations in relation to the agenda for change groupings that we are now trying to resolve for 23-24. I appreciate, Presiding Officer, that there are a wide range of views across the Chamber on what this budget should support, and this debate offers an opportunity for this wider conversation. And I look forward with interest to hearing the perspective from a range of committees in their contribution to the debate today. I thank the Finance and Public Administration Committee for its pre-budget scrutiny report and Stage 1 report, and for its acknowledgement of the wide-ranging challenges facing the Scottish Budget. I will carefully consider the recommendations in the committee's report and reply in writing in due course. With the 23-24 Scottish Budget, I have carefully balanced the growing asks against the funding available. The budget recognises that we need to take action now to enable us to overcome the even greater fiscal challenges that lie ahead. Our approach is set out in our medium-term financial strategy, and we continue to take steps to improve this each year in response to the challenges that face us. And further updates in relation to the implications of the current environment and the different environment to which the convener referred will be set out by the government in due course and likely in the medium-term financial strategy. Critical for the Scottish Government is our continued commitment to ensuring that our public services provide the support that people and communities need, improving outcomes and reducing inequalities whilst remaining fiscally sustainable. The UK Government's financial plans will make this incredibly challenging, with the funding outlook for later years of the spending review period looking increasingly bleak. For these and other reasons, I have taken decisions to increase the higher and top rates of taxation in the next year to boost the revenue available to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament in addressing these questions. Reform of our public services is vital to assure the sustainability of our public services. We have already pursued these issues with public bodies to set out our approach. That approach is built on joining up service delivery to direct resources towards more person-centred services, and in doing so make better use of resources. Our thinking on this issue was set out in some detail in the COVID recovery strategy published just over a year ago. Secondly, we will undertake a rigorous review of the public body landscape, the work that public bodies do, and how resources are used to improve outcomes. This work is not easy, and it's a whole system approach that we know will take time to deliver the results that we require. Thirdly, we're expanding the utilisation of digital technology in the delivery of our public services. And finally, we will carefully manage public sector employment in dialogue with public bodies and with our trade union partners, who must be at the heart of dialogue on all of these questions. Change happens, Presiding Officer, when we all buy into and contribute to a vision of effective, sustainable, person-centred services that's both achievable and ambitious, and that will be the focus of the public service reform work that the Government undertakes. I'd like to place on record my thanks to all of the committees for their scrutiny work on the budget, and I will try to reflect in the time available to me, although I'll come back to some of these questions in my closing speeches when I've heard from committees about some of the issues that we can further address. The Economy and Fair Work Committee acknowledged the current challenging economic circumstances and has expressed interest in the financial support for a range of economic and business areas, including enterprise agencies, tourism and the hospitality sector. The 2023-24 Scottish Budget maximises the support that we can deliver for businesses through the budget directly and through non-domestic rate support mechanisms. With the Health, Social Care and Support Committee, it is acknowledged that the scale of the financial and operational challenge across the health and social care sector is unprecedented. That is why, in the 23-24 Scottish Budget, we will provide over £19 billion of investment in health and social care, an increase of over £1 billion, which has been made possible due to the additional revenue we have raised through our fair and progressive taxation system, which of course exceeds our commitment to pass on all of the health and social care resource consequentials to the health and social care system. The Social Justice and Social Security Committee offered views on a range of social justice and poverty issues. The Government takes these issues seriously, and the response of the Government in the budget to these significant issues, I hope, is commensurate with the seriousness of the issues that are put to us by the committee. We have taken exceptional steps to support Scotland through the cost crisis, and by the end of March 2023, we will have invested around £3 billion in a range of measures to support households. We are also investing £442 million in delivering the Scottish Child Payment, the most ambitious child poverty reduction measure in the United Kingdom. And we hope this measure, along with the uprating of all other Scottish benefits in April 2023 by the September CPI figure, will demonstrate that we have taken a comprehensive package that will forward, which will help us to eliminate child poverty within Scotland. The Education, Children and Young People Committee raised the important issues of colleges, universities, early learning and childcare, and the Education and Skills Resource Budget for next year will increase by £132 million to over £3 billion to enable us to address many of these questions. The Local Government Housing and Planning Committee focused its pre-budget scrutiny on affordable housing. The Government has put in place investment to support the continuation of the long-term affordable housing programme, and we will make available over £750 million for affordable housing next year. The local government settlement has been enhanced by a cash increase of £570 million, or 4.5%, which represents, in terms of the scale of the increase, a real terms increase of 1.3% for local government. The Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee sought evidence on topics including the Fares Fair Review and bus support, heat in buildings and the Joint Budget Review. And we have set out a range of measures, including the investment of over £1.8 billion in heat and energy efficiency over the course of this Parliament to enable us to properly address the challenges put to us by the committee. And also, as we have set out on previous occasions, expand the Fuel Insecurity Fund. In drawing my remarks to a conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, let me just highlight that in the work that we've taken forward in the recent announcement of the Islands deal, we've set out commitments to support our rural and island communities, and the Rural Affairs Budget equally reflects those challenges. I look forward to hearing the reflections of other committees and will reflect on those issues in the closing speech. But I stress the importance of ensuring that we set a budget which utilises the resources available to us, but also makes clear that some very difficult choices have had to be made to get us to the point that we are in. And I look forward to hearing the views of committees as we take forward our constructive engagement on the Scottish Budget.
Thank you very much. First, we now move to the open debate. And I call first Gillian Martin to be followed by Sue Webber for up to 7 minutes. Ms Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Convener of the Health, Social Care and Support Committee, I am pleased to contribute to this afternoon's debate on the budget. And to inform our pre-budget scrutiny, the committee issued a call for written evidence which received a total of 20 responses, and we took oral evidence for selected witnesses on the 20th of September and wrote to the Cabinet Secretary with our recommendations on the 27th of October. And I'm grateful for the Cabinet Secretary's written response of the 15th of December and his appearance before the committee on the 10th of January to answer questions on the budget. The evidence we received highlighted concerns about the unprecedented financial pressures our health and social care services currently face. And those pressures have been exacerbated by the spiralling cost of living, which is having a very damaging effect on the well-being of our citizens and our health and social care workforce. And of course, the vastly increased cost of running the NHS in terms of fuel costs and inflation. Witnesses also highlighted the long-term impacts the COVID-19 pandemic inflicted on the Scottish population's physical and mental health, as well as the well-being of the NHS workforce, and this will require ongoing financial support in the years ahead. And long COVID continues to impact the health and social care workforce, unpaid carers, those receiving care, and the wider population, and that too will continue to come at considerable cost as we find out what the treatments may be for that in the future. However, the impact of the pandemic hasn't been universally negative, because a lot of those responding to our call for evidence were keen to highlight some positive experiences where the experience of the pandemic and how it was managed has helped to drive healthcare delivery innovation. And one of our recommendations to the Scottish Government was that it must continue to foster a culture of innovation in health and social care and ensure improvements to the efficiency and effectiveness of service delivery brought about by the pandemic, or brought about by the management of the pandemic by our health and social care workers, continues to be embedded and built upon. And for that to happen, we need to make sure we're properly monitoring and evaluating the cost-saving benefits of innovation and learning lessons. As one of our witnesses put it to the committee, encouraging innovation includes giving practitioners the confidence to try new approaches. Now, my committee has long asserted that substantial gaps persist in available data related to various aspects of health and social care, and stakeholders contributing to a pre-budget scrutiny told us that this is impeding budget tracking and the assessment of spending against defined outcomes, and it may mean that certain outcomes are not being measured at all. And we do recognise the £1 billion uplift in health spend and the increase in pay for NHS staff in the constrained budgetary environment that the Scottish Government is in. But it's vital that we have the data to be able to measure the impact of that spending accurately against those outcomes and to target finite resources as effectively as possible. Many contributing to our pre-budget scrutiny have highlighted the effect of single-year budgets on longer-term financial planning, and they say that this can hamper efforts to prioritise resources towards preventative spending and to meeting NHS Scotland's stated ambition of becoming a service which is both environmentally and socially sustainable. COSLA wrote in their submission to the committee, "Overall, there remains a continued focus on input and output measures rather than outcomes when it comes to public spending, and this drives behaviour and spending in ways that may not necessarily be the best value." We fully appreciate the immense strain that our health and social care services are currently under. Levels of demand are immediate and acute, and as I've said, they are unprecedented. But prioritising preventative spending and net zero investment is a nettle that we know that we need to grasp if we're to stand any chance of putting health and social care finances on a more sustainable footing in the long term. The committee has called for clarity on when the Scottish Government will bring forward an updated medium-term financial framework for health and social care. And we do recognise this framework does not set budgets, but nonetheless, publishing it would give health and social care decision makers greater certainty and confidence to be able to plan funding longer term and give greater priority to the preventative spending that we know will unlock better health outcomes in the future. And finally, in our letter to the Cabinet Secretary, the committee also emphasised the importance of taking a whole system approach to assessing the health impact of non-health spending. And his response, I commend the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to working with Public Health Scotland to explore better ways to embed the consideration of health issues into decision-making at national and local level. But we also want to recognise the cross-portfolio working on tackling the poverty-related determinants of ill health. And we think this has been a real step change in approach. Assessment on the population health impacts of the cost of living have to be done. There has to be health impacts on assessments on that. The committee has repeatedly made the case for more systematic use of health impact assessments, including as part of the budget process. And I hope that this publication will provide an exemplar for an increasingly systematic application of a health in all policies approach to future budgets. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, there can be no doubting the huge financial challenges the health and social care sectors currently face. But if we are to achieve the goal of placing health and social care finances on that sustainable long-term footing, we as policymakers must retain a focus on longer-term planning, preventative healthcare, and an integrated whole system approach, fostering innovation and effectively measuring our progress and improving those long-term outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Martin. I now call Sue Webber to be followed by Claire Adamson. Up to 7 minutes, Ms. Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I rise today to speak on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee. For its budget scrutiny, we chose to look at both ends of the educational spectrum, early learning and childcare, and further and higher education. August 2021 marked the introduction of the duty on local authorities to secure 1,140 hours of early learning childcare for all 3- and 4-year-olds and eligible 2-year-olds. And you will know that local authorities have a dual role. They are the ELC providers, but they also commission services from PVI nurseries and childminders. Since the rollout of the 1140 hours, PVI providers have faced significant difficulties in recruitment. The Scottish Childminding Association told us that during ELC expansion, the sector has led to the loss of over 1,400 childminders. The National Day Surgeries Association described to us a crisis in the ELC workforce caused by the expansion in local authority employment and the pandemic. Issues raised with us include that rates of pay to providers differ across local authorities, and the Scottish Government guidance doesn't set out a specific rate for local authorities to pay. Therefore, the committee recommended that a mapping exercise should be carried out, because we want to find out what hourly rates are being paid to staff across both local authorities and the PVI sector. We want to know the extent to which staff are moving from jobs in the PVI sector into local authorities, and we want to know the monetary value of in-kind support provided to the PVI sector. We found that the rates paid to the PVI and childminding sectors vary across local authorities. For 3- to 5-year-olds, rates range from £5 an hour in Orkney to £6.40 an hour in West Lothian, and that different rates apply for 2-year-olds, and in some local authorities, different rates are paid to childminders. The committee is aware that a small number of local authorities do not provide an uplift in funding to the PVI sector for 2-year-olds, despite the increase in costs to provide this. We also heard that underfunding is an ongoing concern for many in the PVI sector, several of whom are now operating at a loss. We heard that the Scottish Government is reviewing the overall process for setting these sustainable rates, and we do look forward to receiving information about the financial health of the sector and the critical issue of staff pay and terms and conditions. As part of the inquiry, we learned that some 2-year-olds are eligible for funded places, but the uptake has been low, with the number of eligible 2-year-olds taking up their places standing at around only 13% in 2021. Local authorities have struggled to identify the eligible families, but we were pleased to learn recently that new data sharing arrangements will allow local authorities to target information to eligible households with those 2-year-olds, and we all hope that this will lead to an increase in uptake. The choice of where and when children access funded ELC is very important to parents and caregivers. Private providers can offer greater flexibility than local authority-run settings, and this flexibility is essential to those who don't work around the traditional office hours, for example, healthcare workers, but not only them. Cross-border provision is available between a small number of local authorities, and we heard some evidence on this from Argyll and Bute. But this flexibility, and this flexibility, has been helpful for parents who live and work in different local authority areas. Local authorities are expected to work together to resolve cross-border authority issues, and the Scottish Government has offered to look at what further work might be necessary to allow families across Scotland to access cross-border solutions. I'd like to move on now to another sector offering vital services to people across Scotland, our colleges. Our colleges do fantastic work, and we all want them to thrive and to deliver the skilled workforce that's essential to grow Scotland's economy. We heard about significant funding challenges being faced by our colleges. The Scottish Funding Council said that the sector is forecasting an underlying operating deficit in every academic year up to 2026-27. Staff costs make up a high proportion of colleges' overall costs, and the sector is projecting significant staff reductions of around 200 to 300 full-time equivalent staff members each year in the next 5 years. And yes, I will.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. I realise she's speaking for the committee. Is it the committee's thinking that perhaps we should be giving a bit more to the colleges and a bit less to the universities?
Sue Webber.
I would hate to preempt our college inquiry report that's coming out, Mr Mason. So thank you. If you don't mind, we can wait till later in the year to see that. Although there is a £26 million increase in the college resource budget for this coming year, it is only a 0.6% in real terms. And it's important that colleges find out what that means for baseline funding in the future years. We heard that from Audit Scotland in 2022, because they highlighted that capital funding has consistently fallen short for maintenance in colleges. And further, given that the ability of colleges to raise funds is limited, the committee is concerned that they will not be able to meet their net zero targets by 2045. And we believe that an assessment of the current position and an investment strategy should be completed as a matter of urgency. And finally, I'll speak briefly about universities. Our universities have a fabulous reputation across the world, and we welcome students coming here from across the world and recognise the cultural diversity that they bring. However, Scotland's funding model for universities is now structurally reliant on international fees. With this source of revenue forecast to overtake Scottish Government funding as a percentage of the total sector's total income by 2023-24. We have asked the Scottish Government how it plans to ensure long-term sustainability and how it plans to mitigate the risks of reliance on international student fee income. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm sure that the members in the Chamber would like to join me in thanking the staff who deliver vital services to children and young people across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mrs Webber. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Claire Baker. Up to 7 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome this opportunity to speak in the debate on behalf of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. We focused our pre-budget scrutiny on culture spending portfolio. I would like to thank all of those who attended our roundtables and who submitted evidence to our committee. Culture spend represents a relatively small proportion of the budget. The return on investment in culture and heritage and the arts is significant. Culture enriches our lives, it provides a platform for innovation, and it is of strategic national importance. From the Edinburgh Festivals, which attract over 4 million people to our capital each year, and Scotland's game sector, which contributes £500 million to the economy and is set to become a £1 billion industry by 2030. Our grassroots cultural organisations also work in our communities up and down the country, changing lives every day. And Scotland's cultural heritage is intrinsic to who we are as a nation. It plays a crucial role in how we market and position ourselves globally, Burns Night last night being just one example. But over the last year, the existing budgetary challenges faced by Scotland's culture sector have become much more acute. The evidence we heard was clear, Presiding Officer, and it was sobering. The committee found that the culture sector is experiencing significant financial pressures, driven by, as Ian Munro for Creative Scotland said, a perfect storm. It's reduced income generation, increased operating costs, and longer-term budgetary pressures. This comes as the sector struggles to recover from the COVID pandemic and has been compounded by the cost of living crisis, which is affecting us all. Indeed, we heard that the cost of living crisis presents an even greater short and medium-term challenge to the culture sector than the pandemic. And let's not forget that culture was among those sectors hardest hit during the pandemic. We were told the emergency support provided by the Scottish Government had been essential in helping many cultural organisations stay afloat. But now the sector's already fragile recovery from the pandemic is in doubt, with cultural organisations vulnerable to significantly increased operating costs. And this has followed on from the longer-term budget pressure for the culture sector stemming back to 2010. In its report, A Sustainable Arts Funding System for Scotland, in Session 5 of the Parliament, the Culture Committee pointed to a real terms reduction in funding for the arts. During our evidence sessions, Sir John Layton, Director-General of the National Galleries of Scotland, made it clear to us that the roots of the current financial challenges, the likes of which have never before been witnessed or indeed imagined, lie in the patterns of funding across a longer period. Creative Scotland's core revenue budget has reduced in real terms by approximately £13.1 million since 2010-11. The impact of these longer-term pressures, combined with the further fiscal pressure arising from the recent resource spending review, featured as key themes in the evidence we received. Should the spending review plans prove accurate, the funding for culture and major events would fall in real terms by an estimated 4.7% in 2026, albeit being protected in cash terms. This year's budget settlement for Historic Scotland and the National Galleries of Scotland was welcomed and said to provide a year-long breathing space. But when I consider the rationalising of estates, as Mr Gibson spoke to in his contribution, this is a very different challenge for Historic Scotland than it is for other organisations. Funding for Creative Scotland is down by more than 10%, but this will be offset by the use of national lottery income and reserves, while the Scottish Government faces budget constraints. And while we welcome that the CAB Secretary's reasoning for this decision at committee, this is not recurring money and therefore not a long-term solution. Presiding Officer, the committee recognises that other areas of the budget are also under considerable pressure, and there are therefore no easy budgetary solutions in tackling the considerable difficulties facing our culture sector. But there must now be an increased urgency to accelerate innovative solutions to the funding challenges that culture faces. This includes the development of additional public and private revenue streams to the sector. The committee would want to see progress being made on establishing a percentage for the arts scheme, something consistently raised particularly by our community and third sector organisations. And we should consider how the culture sector could benefit from the proposed transient visitor levy, given the role culture plays in attracting visitors to Scotland. Presiding Officer, the mainstreaming of culture across portfolios is something we have discussed at great length in committee, and we would like to see investment in culture from other budget lines being considered, and the reappraisal of what is considered to be health spending, recognising the contribution that preventative spend in the arts makes towards health and well-being, whether that's through a dementia or COPD choir, or craft classes tackling isolation, stigma and mental health. On the Scottish Government's aim to redirect funding towards demonstrable preventative approaches, we need to see progress. These are recommendations which the committee has made previously, and in the face of the perfect storm, we reiterate them. As the evidence we receive suggests, a strategic approach is still lacking when it comes to mainstreaming culture. To quote Sir John Layton, the ambition to embed culture in the health and well-being is still rotating in mid-air rhetoric. We welcome reassurances from the Cabinet Secretary given to the committee that closer portfolio relationships are being developed, but we need to see this in action. If I could now turn to multi-year funding...
You're going to have to wind up, I'm afraid, Ms Adams, and that's 7 minutes.
Apologies, Presiding Officer, I shall leave it there. Thank you very much.
I appreciate that, Ms Adams, and we are quite tight for time, I'm afraid. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Siobhan Brown, up to 7 minutes, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This time last year, the Economy and Fair Work Committee was calling for support for businesses to recover from the pandemic, encourage investment and create good employment opportunities. At that time, we all acknowledged the challenging economic circumstances, but looking ahead to the next financial year, they will be no less challenging. Indeed, the committee heard that for some sectors, the economic outlook is worse than last year and that business support is even more urgent. I'll focus on two of these sectors, tourism and hospitality. In the lead-up to Christmas, the Scottish Tourism Alliance told the committee that from a business point of view, everyone would say we are in a worse place now than we were last year, without question. In the hospitality sector, wage inflation and the rising costs of food and drink are continuing concerns, but increased energy costs dwarf the problem that businesses were experiencing. We know that tourism can provide sustainable economic growth across Scotland, but the sector is also under severe pressure. So two of the committee's key budget recommendations to the Scottish Government were to, firstly, work with the Scottish Tourism Recovery Group to identify the best business support for the sector, specifically including further business rates support, and secondly, to protect Visit Scotland's international promotional budget, as this expenditure is crucial to maximising income for the sector in 2023-24. The written response to the committee and the Deputy First Minister's evidence to us last week set out the measures the Scottish Government will take to help all businesses, but these didn't include targeted support specifically for the tourism and hospitality sectors. The Scottish Government's plan to freeze the poundage and to create transitional release, which will, together with the small business bonus scheme, benefit some properties in the hospitality sector, are welcome. However, the Economy and Fair Work Committee was strongly in favour of tourism and hospitality sectors being prioritised for business rate support. We are disappointed that enhanced targeted support for these sectors is not on the table, given the concerns being expressed. Similarly, in response to the committee's call to protect Visit Scotland's international promotional budget, the Scottish Government's written response did not provide comfort. At her evidence session last week, the Deputy First Minister sought to provide assurances that joint promotional work can be undertaken with a range of partners, creating efficiencies, and that there had been a shift in the direction of digital marketing. The committee acknowledges that Visit Scotland is effective with its marketing spend, but remains of the view that it would be short-sighted to cut back on the budget for international promotional spend. There's a real opportunity for bringing spending power to Scotland, one which would support our tourism and our hospitality sectors. There is strong evidence that international visitors stay longer and spend more in local economies. Investment in this area brings financial rewards and supports regional economies, an opportunity recognised in Ireland, which announced a £62 million investment into tourism attractions. The committee does not underestimate the financial pressures facing the government, but we want to see opportunities grasped and would be supportive of readjustment of other funds in this area towards international tourism. The second key committee recommendation I will highlight relates to the Scottish Government's commitment to establish a women's business centre. The committee and many stakeholders welcomed the Scottish Government's programme for government that earmarked £50 million over the life of this parliament to establish a women's business centre. We know that women experience difficulties in accessing financial support from traditional sources, and there's a lack of gender disaggregated data on women's businesses and procurement activity. We also know that women tend to run smaller businesses, but there are problems accessing finance. Any business will lack the structural capital to grow or expand trade, get the right networks in place, and to take advantage of opportunities. In this year's pre-budget letter, the committee noted there's a significant opportunity from enhancing women's contribution to Scotland's economy. We asked for the establishment of the Women's Business Centre to be prioritised in this year's budget. The committee was therefore very disappointed that there seems to have been no discernible progress. In December, we asked the Deputy First Minister how much of the earmarked £50 million would be spent this coming financial year. In response, we were referred to the review being undertaken by Anna Stewart about widening access to entrepreneurship for women. The committee was told that long-term funding decisions have not yet been made. I would point out that the Anna Stewart review was commissioned last April, and at that time it was reported that full findings and recommendations would be available in September. We are still awaiting them. I have to say that the response that we received from the government did sound rather conditional. The committee are convinced of the benefits of a women's business centre and wants to see this progressed. This again would be a good example of the government being able to grasp opportunities, and we know there is so much to be gained from women being greater involved in the economy. Presiding officer, there are two other issues identified as the committee for spending priorities in the coming year. We want to see a focus on skills development and to incentivise workplace learning for engineering and manufacturing sectors in particular. And we want to see investment to support these sectors, which have a buoyant export potential, to expand, an opportunity that we will focus on in terms of green energy transition support. I will also close on employability spend. Along with the Finance Committee, we also have concerns in this area. At the start of September, the Deputy First Minister announced that savings of at least £50 million are needed. This included £53 million of employability support spending. Employability services support those who wish to work but face barriers to do so, and there can be many reasons why some people find it difficult to get into work. The Fraser Allender Institute have published a very good analysis of employability spend and why it is important. At the Conveners Group meeting with the First Minister, and again last week when the Deputy First Minister was at the committee, I sought clarification on this reduction. The committee was told that this was removal of a projected increase to planned expenditure and not a reduction to any spend on programmes currently being delivered. The committee understands that savings have to be found. We noted the assurances given that there still remains capacity in existing employability programmes to take on new programme entrants. But this is an area the committee will wish to monitor. We are currently taking evidence on the disability employment gap, and we remain concerned that the impact of this reduction is removing opportunity from people who may be furthest from the workplace, but they are people who not only deserve to be included in the workforce and in society, but they also have a valuable contribution to make to Scotland's economy. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Very grateful, Mr. Baker. I now call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Up to 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's my pleasure to speak on behalf of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee on our pre-budget scrutiny work. And I thank all those who gave evidence to the committee and responded to our call for views, which informed our letter to the government in advance of the publication of the budget documents in December. And I know we have stage one on the budget bill coming up itself, but I think it is important that we have this debate today to hear how pre-budget scrutiny work of committees has helped influence and shape the Scottish Government's budget. To begin, our committee agreed to focus its scrutiny on the ongoing costs associated with the pandemic as set out in the COVID-19 strategic framework and how the Scottish Government planned to fund its COVID recovery strategy. We were interested in the read across between these strategic documents and the Scottish Government's other fiscal documents such as the resource spending review, the medium-term financial strategy and the Equality and Fairer Scotland statement. Before I go on to talk about our pre-budget work, I would just like to say, although thankfully we're no longer in an emergency situation, for a lot of people, COVID is not over, particularly those who have suffered loss and those who are trying to cope with long COVID, and I offer my sympathies to them. These people are always at the forefront of our work and our pre-budget scrutiny on the recovery strategy and strategic framework, with no exception. Moving on specifically to our pre-budget work, the committee heard evidence on three main themes: COVID recovery and the cost crisis, ongoing COVID and pandemic preparedness associated with the strategic framework, and the outcomes-based budgeting and policy evaluation associated with the recovery strategy. The committee also touched on the wellbeing economy and considered the read across between the Scottish Government's strategic documents and how they support the government's stated aim of achieving a wellbeing economy. I'll take these themes in turn. Firstly, on COVID recovery and the cost crisis, we asked the government to clarify whether budgetary and inflationary pressures had impacted on its priorities and the ability to deliver on the outcomes as set out in the COVID recovery strategy. And as we've already heard in this debate, the government has confirmed the cost crisis has indeed had an impact, but it is still committed to making progress towards the shared COVID recovery strategy outcomes. And the response to our pre-budget letter also highlighted that the recovery strategy will run up to September 2023. We asked the Deputy First Minister about this last week when he came to give evidence on the budget, and he explained that the aim is to mainstream COVID recovery across all portfolios. I fully expect this committee to be involved in ensuring that this mainstreaming is done effectively. We also called for more clarity and transparency on funding directed and achieving the priorities and outcomes set out in the recovery strategy, and more detail on the evaluation and the effectiveness of these funding allocations. I was pleased that the government agreed that the budget transparency was important, and the response highlighted in its commitment to the delivery of the national outcomes as set out in the national performance framework, and that its budget was set accordingly. This is an area of continued interest to the committee, and I'll talk more about this later. Moving on to the ongoing COVID costs and the pandemic preparedness associated with the strategic framework, we considered the report of the Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness and its recommendations and looked at the budgetary implications of the ongoing costs dealing with COVID. We asked for an assurance that the government would commit additional resources to implement the strategic framework if this was required to respond to a new variant of concern or a mutation in the future. This point was made by a number of witnesses, and the government has said it remains alert to the threat posed by a potential new COVID variant. It also pointed to the plans published by Public Health Scotland that sets out the processes that will be undertaken to identify and assess any future risk. We also heard about the importance of funding the ongoing activities in relation to vaccinations, surveillance, testing and PPE, and was reassured by the government's commitment to allocate funds for these measures. Ongoing surveillance in particular was an issue we focused on and have since explored further, and we wanted to understand how the wastewater surveillance played a major part in identifying COVID outbreaks during the pandemic, and how this and genomic sequencing could continue to be used in the event of any future outbreak. We looked at what future investment may be needed in surveillance measures and genomic sequencing for the ongoing COVID-19 response and future pandemic preparedness. And I'm sure members from all parties would agree we don't ever want to be in the position where we're not ready to respond for another variant to emerge, or if it's so important that, despite the current fiscal pressures, the government allocates appropriate funding to the pandemic preparedness and ongoing surveillance measures. We heard good preparedness measures need to a baseline level funding, and that project funding isn't sustainable in terms of recruitment. We also heard the learning from PPE that stocks should be actively used rather than just warehoused. Turning briefly to the outcomes-based budget and policy evaluation, which is an issue which is of continued interest to us, in considering the funded policies contained in the recovery strategy, we were keen to know how the success or otherwise of certain policies can influence future policies and government budgets. We explored the OECD's COVID-19 recovery dashboard, which was developed to monitor how different countries are performing in the context of recovery. And during evidence, the Deputy First Minister acknowledged that one of the challenges in deciding public expenditure priorities is assessing the most effective use of public expenditure at any given moment. In light of the evidence heard by the committee, we recommended that the government consider an OECD COVID-19 recovery dashboard and explores whether Scotland should adopt a similar approach to monitoring its recovery from the pandemic. Indeed, we considered the OECD dashboard in more detail just last week in advance of our session with the Deputy First Minister. In response, the government again referred to the National Performance Framework and its similarities with the dashboard as a tool for measuring recovery through the stated outcomes relating to Scotland's economy, environment and well-being. Finally, on the well-being economy, something that we have been an interest for other committees, we heard differing views on what exactly constitutes a well-being economy, and that it was not clear how the National Performance Framework is used as a policy decision-making tool to help deliver a well-being economy. Presiding Officer, I will conclude. It is worth reiterating that one of the core objectives of the budget process is to improve transparency and raise public understanding and awareness on the budget. And Presiding Officer, I believe our pre-budget scrutiny has achieved this objection in relation to COVID spend. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Up to 7 minutes, Ms. Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's my pleasure to contribute to this debate in my capacity as convener of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. The committee's pre-budget scrutiny this year focused primarily on the budget for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. I will touch on that scrutiny, but I will also want to focus on the work the committee has undertaken in the predicament of local government budgets and the challenges ahead for local government. In recent months, the committee has been holding evidence sessions on the interrelated issues of budget allocations for local government, the New Deal for local government, and the local governance review. As the committee, we are yet to draw any conclusions on these matters, but I want to highlight some of the key issues arising out of these sessions. To begin with, however, I will reflect on our work programme on fund of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. As I said at the outset, this was the focus for our pre-budget scrutiny, but we also held sessions on this issue earlier in the session and will continue to do so as we move through the session. Each time we take evidence on the issue, we find the challenges faced by the housing sector are that bit more severe. than the previous time we took evidence on it. In particular, the costs of construction appear to continue to rise each time we explore them with stakeholders. We note that while the capital grants budget for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme has been reduced, this reduction has to some extent been mitigated by an increase in financial transaction funding. That being said, as the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government recognised in her evidence to the committee, the increasing cost of construction means that this investment does not deliver the same returns as it once did. In the context of the existing grant funding regime, the prospect of meeting the Scottish Government's targets for building affordable homes seems increasingly remote at the moment. As a committee, we recognise that to meet these targets, there needs to be a focus on innovative financing methods. We welcome the Scottish Government's recognition of this need and its establishment of an innovative finance steering group. The committee is keen to be kept up to date with the work of this group and encourages the Scottish Government to ensure that this work is progressed as a matter of urgency. We also recognise that the pressures on social landlords are not limited to the delivery of new stock, but extend to investment required to decarbonise their stock, as well as maintaining that stock. The committee will continue this session to explore how social landlords meet these competing priorities in the current financial climate. And lastly, on housing, I'd like to emphasise that in investing in affordable housing, we must ensure that we are building homes that meet the varied and complex needs of all of Scotland's people and that placemaking objectives are being achieved. It should not simply be a case of delivering housing numbers alone. As I said at the beginning of my speech, though, I also want to look at the committee's exploration of the funding challenges being faced by local government. Each day seems to bring yet more news of seemingly insurmountable problems faced by local government. Amongst other things, councils are having to face the challenges of pay inflation and living wage costs, costs associated with COVID-19 recovery, energy inflation, non-pay inflation, including cost of materials, construction costs, and contract inflation. Demand for and price sensitivity of chargeable services and the related impact on income from fees and charges. There is universal recognition that local government does not currently have the fiscal levers to meet all of these challenges. In this context, we have been exploring the potential impact of the New Deal between the Scottish Government and local government, including the government's commitment to introducing a fiscal framework as well as fiscal empowerment issues in the local governance review. A new relationship agreed between local government and the Scottish Government will be central to enabling local government to respond to the challenge it faces. We welcome the ambitions of the New Deal. In the programme for government, it envisaged a New Deal would enable local and national government to work together to achieve better outcomes for people, balance greater flexibility over financial arrangements with improved accountability, provide certainty over inputs, outcomes, and assurance alongside scope to innovate and improve services, recognise the critical role played by local authorities in tackling the climate emergency, for example, through delivering heat in buildings, waste, active travel, and nature restoration goals. We took evidence from council leaders before Christmas, and they in particular stressed the importance of multi-year settlements so councils can continue to provide services and meet new and emerging needs. They also emphasised the need for increased financial flexibilities, including more fiscal powers to allow councils to meet local needs. It seems conceivable that the New Deal, as currently envisaged, could provide the certainty of funding and financial flexibility sought. This year, as every year, our scrutiny of the budget was dominated by the disagreement between COSLA and the Scottish Government on whether or not there has been an increase in funding to local government and what proportion of the funding settlement is ring-fenced or directed. It is critical that any new deal must provide greater clarity on these matters in the future. It was originally envisaged that the new deal would be in place for the new financial year. The Cabinet Secretary told the committee that it would take a few more months, but efforts to reach an agreement would be turbocharged. It is critical that we get this right, so taking longer and reaching a better agreement has to be welcomed. In saying that, this can't drag on for years to come. The predicament of local government is such that a long delay will not be sustainable. The local governance review is nearly 6 years old. The New Deal can't go on the same trajectory. We look forward to scrutinising the New Deal in the coming months. We also look forward to scrutinising the upcoming tourist levy bill. As a committee, we are keen to explore how local authorities can raise more of their own revenue while recognising that core funding from Scottish Government will still be essential to local authorities meeting the challenges they face. Finally, certainty of funding, flexibility in the use of funding and increased revenue raising will not in of themselves answer all the challenges faced by local government. In his introduction to the recent Accounts Commission Local Government Finance Bulletin, William Moyes states, "If councils are to find a safe path through the difficult times ahead, they need to focus more on service reform based on strong engagement with communities. As a committee, we recognise that we are now 12 years on from the Christie Commission. As much as a new deal is needed, so too is service reform, and we look forward to playing our part in driving that change."
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Finlay Carson, up to 7 minutes, Ms Nicholl. Excuse me, Ms Nicholl, your microphone... there we go.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Likewise, I am pleased to speak as the Convener of the Criminal Justice Committee in this debate. And firstly, I thank committee clerks for their support during the budget scrutiny process and all members of the committee who worked collegiately together during our scrutiny process. And I would also like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for his attendance at committee on the 23rd of December to give evidence as part of that process. The justice spending portfolio covers the very important work of our police and fire services, our prisons and courts, and many other key bodies that are critical to the safety of the public, such as third sector charities. And it's for these reasons that the committee was concerned to read the resource spending review of May last year, which proposed flat cash settlements for the years ahead. Spice estimated that this would mean that resource spending in our remit could fall in real terms by £102 million and that capital spending may also decrease in real terms by £5.2 million. So for individual bodies such as Police Scotland, the Scottish Prison Service and the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service, we'd been looking at real terms reductions of nearly 8%, according to Spice. Clearly, that would have had a very significant implication for criminal justice bodies, and indeed much of the evidence we heard from different organisations was stark and reflected their concerns about the potential impact on their function, their staff and effective delivery. And I thank all of those who gave evidence to us and for the candid way in which they set out the challenges ahead, such as how they could fund decent pay increases for their staff if the resource spending review plans were to come to pass. So, for example, Police Scotland told us that for every 1% in police pay in the future, that would cost £11 million per year to fund, which equates to around 225 staff. So hence, a 5% pay increase would cost about £222 million per year and could equate to a reduction of just over 4,400 officers and staff if no extra money was forthcoming. Similarly, the Scottish Prison Service's chief executive said that there is no, or at most very limited, opportunity to the scaling back of operations without significant risk to health and welfare support, reputational damage, the loss of services, and the risk to operational stability across the estate. In our courts, we heard the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service might have to reduce summary and civil business by up to 25%, cut back on the £3 million that goes into that budget to pay for part-time judiciary, and look at the unpalatable option of reducing staff numbers. We also heard from senior staff in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service that savings of between £29 million and £43 million would equate to a reduction of approximately 780 whole-time firefighter posts, or around 20 to 25% of the whole-time firefighting workforce. So it's for these reasons and others that the Criminal Justice Committee said that the Scottish Government should find extra resources in its budget to provide a better settlement for organisations in the criminal justice sector than that proposed in the spending review.
John Mason.
I appreciate the member giving way. I mean, she says about the government finding extra resources, and our committee convener talked about how we need to balance the budget. So did the committee have any suggestions as to where these resources should come from? For example, cutting the NHS, raising tax, or something else?
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for his intervention. And yes, I think it's uppermost in everybody's mind, not just the committee members, about if you're going to increase one budget somewhere, you need to look at where that's coming from. So we certainly were very conscious of that. But our priority in the budget scrutiny process was to look at the evidence we were taking from the sector and reflect that in our report to the Cabinet Secretary. Sorry, I just lost my place. So we also said that any extra resources that could be provided needed to do more than just be used to support any pay increase awards within the sector. In his response to our budget report, the Cabinet Secretary gave assurances that he had absolutely no intention of overseeing a budget for the police force that results in 4,000 officers leaving, and that he also wanted to protect the provision of high-quality services in our prisons and courts. Presiding Officer, I welcome these assurances, and I also welcome the fact that the Cabinet Secretary has been able to negotiate an additional £165 million to be invested to address the significant pressures on the justice system. And I note also that the capital budget for the sector will increase by £37.4 million in 2023-24, which is very welcome. Presiding Officer, we know the Cabinet Secretary has had to make some hard choices here, and I trust that our pre-budget scrutiny and the evidence we took has helped him in his process of decision making. I would, however, note that despite the extra resource, there will have to be some difficult choices made. So, to conclude, Presiding Officer, the committee will be happy to work in partnership with the Scottish Government and other criminal justice bodies in 2022-23-24 and beyond to prioritise spending and make the best use of the money available. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Nicholl. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Up to 7 minutes, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to contribute to today's debate on behalf of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee. The RAIN Committee has focused its pre-budget scrutiny on two areas. Firstly, the committee wanted to understand the impact the inflationary pressures had on the RAIN portfolio, and secondly, the implementation of the Islands Plan and associated island programme funding, specifically in regards to the addressing population decline. The RAIN portfolio has only seen a reduction of 0.1% since 22-23, but this masks some changes to the detail, and the real impact of inflation equates to a reduction in the Rural Affairs and Island portfolio of 3.3%. In addition, the £500 million of saving to tackle the cost of living crisis has had an impact, with over £60 million of savings coming from the RAIN budget, including £33 million in savings from rural support. The rural support savings were described as a deferral of UK government ring-fenced funds to be returned to the RAIN committee to the RAIN portfolio in future years, and the committee will continue to monitor these deferred funds in the next financial year. In light of these budgetary and inflationary pressures, the committee sought to understand how the Scottish Government will support farmers and crofters. In evidence, the Cabinet Secretary assured the committee that our priority was providing stability to the sector, citing both the direct cash injection of £650 million into the portfolio and also the expedited direct payments. In February, the committee will kick off its pre-legislative scrutiny of the Agriculture Bill. This legislation and associated policies will be vitally important for the future of the agricultural sector, forming the framework by which we will support farmers and crofters to transition to a more sustainable model. This section of the budget has received a significant increase of 69.6% compared with last year. This comes from a doubling of the funding for the National Test Programme from $10 million to $20 million, and an increase of $3 to $5.2 for the delivery costs of the programme. Alongside the Agricultural Transformation Fund, the Government says that this funding is intended to support the transformation of how farming and food production is supported in Scotland, and for Scotland to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture, and to support the industry to achieve our statutory emissions targets. The National Test Programme and the Agricultural Transformation Fund are recent budget packages to support agricultural reform. Looking at the last few years, the overall budget for these activities is still significantly below the original budget set out for the Agricultural Transformation Fund when it was announced in February 2020. Furthermore, uptake of soil tests and carbon audits have been lower than expected, with only 12 claimants for carbon audits and 21 claims for soil samples as of December 2022. It is, however, expected that applications will reach a peak towards the closing date. The Cabinet Secretary also confirmed our ambition to expand the National Test Programme, pointing to animal health and welfare measures that could be added to the programme. The committee scrutinised the National Test Programme as part of its pre-legislative scrutiny to ensure the programmes are delivering on the Scottish Government's ambition and, importantly, ensuring they are adequately supporting farmers. At the other end of the supply chain, business development will see a significant decrease of 78.8% in the capital spend, from $16 million to $3.4 million. This relates to the Food Processing Monitoring Cooperation Scheme, a scheme designed to support the development of food and drink processing businesses. Not running this financial year is where the savings comes from. This, according to the Scottish Government, is to allow a review to ensure the scheme addresses further sectoral challenges and better serves the need of the industry. This is disappointing, as the scheme appears to have been well received and post-COVID has and would continue to support struggling businesses to recover. This is a budget line that we will continue to monitor over the future years. The committee would have liked to have seen the scheme maintained at least until the economic situation had stabilised. Marine Scotland has received an increase of $14 million, or 14.7%, in the budget to support commitment to net zero and biodiversity, including initiatives like the Marine National Plan, designating highland protected marine areas and implementing policies from the fisheries management strategy, such as remote electronic monitoring and future catch policy. Marine Scotland stated that much of the increased budget relates to additional staffing and research capability required to deliver a successful planning and consenting regime for offshore renewables and an increased focus on marine conservation activity. The committee discussed this uplift with the Marine Scotland budget with the Cabinet Secretary, and we raised concerns that this shift to offshore renewables could further contribute to spatial squeeze in the marine environment. The Cabinet Secretary acknowledged potential impacts and committed to continuously review operations. The committee will continue to monitor how progress has been made to balance commercial interests with wider conservation activities to ensure the equitable use of marine areas. We raise concerns about Marine Scotland's capability to cope with its increased responsibilities and encourage the Scottish Government to undertake an assessment of its operational capacity to ensure compliance with anticipated expansion of marine environmental protection. Finally, turning to the islands, the committee scrutinised the implementation of the Islands Plan, specifically the Associated Islands Programme funding, taking evidence from local authorities and the Scottish Futures Trust. Local authorities painted a stark picture of the impact inflationary pressures were having on island communities. Argyll and Bute Council highlighted that travel and fuel costs are effectively 185% and 70% higher than those in urban UK areas. These significantly higher costs make securing capital projects more challenging for island authorities. Although the committee is pleased that the Scottish Government has taken on board our comments regarding how funding can be improved in future years, it's disappointing the Government decided to reduce the capital element in the island programme budget in real terms, particularly given the inflationary pressures. The Cabinet Secretary acknowledged the constraints on the island programme budget and highlighted the island's growth deal, providing $50 million from the Scottish Government and $50 million from the UK Government over the next few years. While the island growth deal is to be welcome, local authorities tell us that they have a need for a greater degree of certainty about the funding they will receive so they can plan ahead. This is particularly relevant to capital projects which need a pipeline to give contractors certainty that projects will get the green light. When the committee wrote to the Cabinet Secretary, it appeared that there was a concerted move to provide the certainty on a multi-annual basis, and the Cabinet Secretary confirmed that multi-annual funds were not possible due to the annual allocation process, but didn't commit to providing as much certainty and clarity as possible. Presiding Officer, scrutiny will continue on how the island plan and programme funding can be improved to deliver for our island communities, and I hope in the coming years we'll get the chance to visit some of these projects funded under the programme to see what impact they're having on the ground.
Thank you very much, Mr Carson. I now call Natalie Dawn to be followed by Edward Mountain. Up to 7 minutes, Ms Dawn.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee in the Finance and Public Administration Committee's debate on the Scottish Budget. During this budget cycle, we have been acutely aware of the challenging economic circumstances in which the Scottish Government has prepared its budget. Notwithstanding this, the committee has been keen to ensure that budgetary decisions within its remit focus on protecting those on low incomes, as they are the most affected by this cost of living crisis. This crucially includes the third sector, which provides vital support to some of the most marginalised groups. To support this work, the committee has also examined how the Scottish Government is taking a human rights approach to its budget decisions and what this means for achieving social justice and addressing inequality. The cost of living crisis has brought poverty and the right to an adequate standard of living into sharp focus. The Scottish Human Rights Commission drew our attention to the need for poverty to be viewed in human rights terms and emphasised, "Poverty represents a failure, a violation to fulfil the right to an adequate standard of living as is established in international human rights law." Other rights, like the right to education, to work and decent working standards, to health and adequate food and adequate housing, are also affected by poverty. Poverty viewed through this lens is thus best viewed as a cluster of human rights violations in Scotland. As one of its four key priorities set out in the resource spending review, the Scottish Government has prioritised tackling child poverty. We welcome the increase in the Scottish Child Payment to £25 per eligible child per week, which the Cabinet Secretary has indicated should reduce relative poverty to 1%, below the interim target of 18%. Of course, we will not know whether this is the case until statistics are available in 2025, and the committee will therefore keep a watchful eye on progress throughout this session. With inflationary increases eroding the value of financial interventions, we actively encourage other committees to keep challenging the government to tackle child poverty through policies that lie within their remit. Social security is just one way to invest in people. The committee notes that in 2023-24, the Scottish Government needs to find £776 million above what it receives in social security block grant adjustments, and this is more than double what is needed this financial year. According to the Scottish Fiscal Commission's recent forecast, this funding requirement is expected to continue to grow, reaching £1.4 million by 2027-28. How to address this gap and the impact of the cost of living crisis proved to be a little more controversial for the committee, but we wait to hear the outcome of the review of the fiscal framework and whether this will ease the pressure. Still, the fact remains, rightly, that social security is a demand-led budget, and as such, funding will need to be made available. It is therefore critical that we double down on preventative measures. We heard that for preventative policies to make a difference and to lead to sustainable and consistent improvements, measures need to be funded over the longer term. We took evidence from the Deputy First Minister to discuss the £53 million in-year cut to employability funding. The committee was concerned that this would slow progress on parental employment, a preventative approach aimed at reducing child poverty. We recommended the cut should be time-limited and asked the Scottish Government to provide a timescale in which it will be reinstated to the level of funding before the cut. In response, the Government has committed to reinstating funding for 2023-24. As I set out at the beginning of my speech, we've maintained our focus on the funding issues faced by the third sector. The issues experienced by the sector are long-running. The pandemic, swiftly followed by the cost of living crisis, has, however, seen the situation worsen to levels not encountered before. Voluntary organisations face increased costs, including, amongst others, transport, supplier and material costs and rent, the most significant being energy and staffing costs. SCVO reminded us the sector provides public services, and they advised voluntary organisations employ more than 135,000 people, which is 5% of the Scottish workforce. The Poverty and Inequality Commission explained the impact on volunteers. They told us volunteers who were offering to drive to deliver packages and care support to people can no longer afford the fuel. On the consequences of single-year funding on advice services, the Child Poverty Action Group said short-term funding means that they cannot take someone on and train them up because by the time they've done that, the funding will be over and the person will have had to leave. So the Scottish Government has acknowledged the sector needs stability of funding and the opportunity for longer-term planning and development. The Cabinet Secretary advised us the Government has adopted fairer funding practice and that it is committed to increasing multi-year funding, with multi-year settlements being the default wherever possible, and this is a welcome step forward. We will, of course, be following progress to see if this approach is having the desired impact on the sector, as we are aware other grant funders also need to deliver multi-year funding. Before I come to the end of my speaking time, I'd like to cover homelessness. Having a place to call home is an important aspect of an adequate standard of living. Following publication of the budget, Shelter Scotland raised concerns that funding for homelessness services had been frozen and that funding for delivery of new social homes had been cut, impacting on the Scottish Government's international obligations to progressive realisation of rights. We asked the Cabinet Secretary about this and she clarified that funding for the Affordable Housing Programme remains at £3.5 billion, however recognised that this translates to a real terms reduction from the previous budget. This, the Cabinet Secretary noted, is due to the impact of high inflation and a 3.4% real terms reduction in the UK Government capital allocation to the Scottish Government between 2022-23 and 2023-24. The Cabinet Secretary did, however, highlight that the Government was taking steps to mitigate the impact. On funding to eradicate homelessness, the Cabinet Secretary hoped having two clear purposes. Reducing the use of temporary accommodation and the prevention of homelessness would bring about a sharper focus. And again, we will continue to scrutinise progress in this area. In conclusion, we have used our scrutiny to ensure the Scottish Government's budget takes account of low-income households and the impact of poverty and related preventative actions. We acknowledge this coming year's budget is set against a very challenging fiscal context, not least because of the current cost of living crisis. It is essential in times like these that the budget works to maintain the right to an adequate standard of living for the people of Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Edward Mountain to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to give an overview of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee's scrutiny of the 2023-24 budget. The main backdrop for this work has been the committee's inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectorial partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland by 2045. That was the inquiry title, which is almost as long as the inquiry was. It started in November 2021 and touched on almost every aspect of the net zero delivery at local level. This made a very useful primer for our budget scrutiny this year. Our report came out on Monday, and I do urge all members to have a read, at least of our executive summary, which is just 2 pages long and gets straight to the point. In it, we say that Scotland will not meet its ambitious target of being net zero by 2045 without a more empowered local government sector with better access to the skills and capital it will need to play a full role in this energy revolution. To be clear, this means that councils are going to need additional core resources to help meet the cost of transition. There'll be a chance to debate this report, so I will move on from it now, but touch on 3 issues we highlighted in our pre-budget scrutiny. The first is public transport. There is a fair fares review covering pricing for all main modes of public transport. Our budget letter expressed concerns that the review had a low profile and its timetabling and outcomes were unclear. We asked for more clarity on all this, and also on what resources the Scottish Government anticipated setting aside at the end of the review to help achieve the significant modal shift away from car use that we all want to see. It's fair to say that the Cabinet Secretary's response was perhaps clearer on the first point than the second. We sought to tease out the discussion in a public session with the Cabinet Secretary last week, and this was helpful to have clarification that the pilot scheme to be run under the review to remove peak fares on trains will only apply in some services, but not nationally. The Cabinet Secretary reminded us that it is buses, not trains, that are far the most widely used of public transport. But the sector has been struggling, especially since the COVID pandemic. The committee acknowledged the resource the Scottish Government has put behind the sector to help it see out these difficult times. But we want to be assured that there are policies in place that will ensure the sector not only survives, but thrives in the longer terms, not least because we're going to need a strong bus sector to help us decarbonise transport. Whether we are there yet is not clear. For instance, councils are still clearly some way away from making use of their new power to run local bus services. I'm sure that this is something the committee will want to keep an eye on over the rest of the parliamentary session. Besides the local government inquiry, the other main evidential source for our pre-budget scrutiny was the committee's snapshot inquiry in late spring last year on energy price rises. At the time, the outlook looked very bleak indeed, with truly frightening forecasts being made of all of bills householders would have to pay by the end of the year. If matters seem just a little less bleak now, I hope that this is due to, in part, to the call by the committee and that others were making last year for a clear and decisive confidence-restoring intervention by government, principally the UK government, but the Scottish government also had an important role to play too. One area that is largely devolved is home insulation. On our pre-budget correspondence, we set out a disappointment at the apparent lack of urgency in escalating retrofitting and insulation programmes in response to the fuel crisis. The underlying issue here is overall heat in building strategy and how to play for it, an issue again touched on in our local government inquiry, and one I suggest that the Parliament will need to return to in greater depth during this parliamentary session. Finally, and very briefly, I'd like to draw the Parliament's attention to the committee's work in seeking to commit the Scottish Government to greater transparency on the carbon footprint of the national budget, so that we, as parliamentarians, can make a more informed decision at this time each year. There is no doubt this is tricky and technical work, but to paraphrase John F. Kennedy when he announced the Apollo mission, we do this not because it is easy, but because it is hard. Or rather, we ask the Scottish Government to do it. To their credit, they have undertaken to do so, albeit rather guardedly, and I will give an undertaking on behalf of the committee to hold them to this commitment over the course of this session and ensure that progress is made in this really important area. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call John Mason to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And being on the Finance Committee, we obviously do have quite a focus on the budget for a fair part of the year. And at the risk of repeating myself from previous years, the Scottish budget has to be as fair as we can make it, and it has to meet as many needs as we possibly can. But it also has to be affordable, and so it can never meet every need as we would ideally like. So in the first place, I very much welcome the effort to increase our resources so that we have more to spend on vital public services, like the NHS and local government. I welcome the income tax increases, adding just 1 pence to the 41 pence and 46 pence rates. The UK tax system is far too complex and inconsistent. As long as national insurance remains separate and regressive, and as long as income tax, corporation tax and capital gains tax are not more closely aligned with each other, we will get inconsistencies and artificial behaviour to avoid tax, like people who are really employees but become companies in order to pay less tax. As the Deputy First Minister said at committee on the 10th of January, such behaviour may be legal, but it is also, quote, morally wrong, unquote. As people living in Scotland benefit from things like no university tuition fees and better early learning and childcare, so we should be paying more tax for these advantages. Most people do not choose which country to live in based on the lowest tax. They look at overall quality of life, they want a sense of community, and obviously they want to be close to family and friends. While income tax is fairly progressive, and that is welcome, our property taxes are not so progressive, And this point was made by Professor Anton Muscatelli and the expert panel. I do welcome the increase in additional dwelling supplement from 4% to 6%. It is only a 2% change, but can help to swing the balance towards first-time buyers and away from second homeowners and those buying to rent. This has to be a good thing. I, for one, bought my flat when I was younger, and many did so at that time on fairly ordinary wages and salaries. But it has become increasingly hard for younger people to purchase, and we need to do what we can to help them. It is probably worth saying at this point that the committee had a very useful full-day conference with the RSE on taxation in Scotland in November. There have also been good papers on taxation from the IPPR and others, and I strongly believe that we need to get the general public more involved in discussing tax and where we as a nation want to be going. Do we want lower taxes and to see public services decline? Or do we want high-quality public services with higher taxes to pay for them? And while on the bigger picture side of things, we should mention the fiscal framework. I very much welcome the fact that it is being reviewed. Now, I know that we signed up to it fairly voluntarily. However, it does seem to me that it is fundamentally biased against Scotland. We cannot really compete with London, the south east of England, so we are going to keep losing out unless the framework is changed. Finally, coming to the corporate body budget, I was very concerned to see that the proposal for the commissioners and the ombudsman is an 8.1% increase. On top of that, we heard that there are calls for the number of commissioners to increase to 14. I think we need to remember that this is money being taken away from actual services. Every pound for the commissioners is £1 less for frontline services. And lastly, concerning MSPs getting a pay increase of 1.5%, I think this is reasonable in the circumstances, and I personally very much welcome it. So overall, we would all like to do more than this budget can do. However, our room for manoeuvre is limited, and I think there is a very reasonable and realistic budget in the circumstances and should be supported. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Liz Smith to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
I'm not here next week.
You've got your microphone on, Douglas. It's Douglas's that's on. Liz, they've got Douglas's on by mistake, and mine now. Thank you.
I think we're on now. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome the budget report? And can I also thank our clerks and our special adviser? And can I also thank the convener for his level-headed approach, at least most of the time, on the task in hand. And it is an important one, not just because budgets are always important, but because this one is set against some very difficult circumstances, much more than usual. Now, stage one next week will see us all take our party political stances on the budget, but for today's debate, I think it's much more about the main issues that have been raised during our evidence sessions. And central to that is obviously the ambition to raise increasing amounts of revenue, but also at the same time to improve productivity in Scotland, the tax take, and to address the issues about the working population level set against the total population. And of course that means policies which will encourage more people back into the labour force following the pandemic and addressing the very large number of people who've actually never worked at all. And that raises questions about what are, and most importantly about what should be, public expectations of the state. And I'm sure Mr Swinney will agree that the Scottish Government can't be expected to do everything. And I think we should note at this point that it is the perceived wisdom of so many economic commentators and of key business groups such as the CBI in Scotland that we are in desperate need of more highly paid jobs. It was a point raised at yesterday's event with the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Scotland is far too prone to low capacity on economic growth, and as we heard yesterday, there are serious future issues relating to this. And with that concern about economic growth, I think it raises some of the tensions. A couple of conveners actually mentioned this, about how we strive to find a balance between our commitments on the green economy with also ensuring that traditional industry is able to perform in a way that can provide enough high salaries. But it also raises questions about what policies will best encourage investment in our better industries in terms of the future of financial services and renewables and energy and high-tech manufacturing, these are the areas which I think are very much in the running to produce some of these high-paid jobs. And another issue that's been very much talked about at committee is that of behavioural change on the back of the estimates that are being provided to us. And my colleague Michelle Thompson is quite right, has raised this several times at the committee, that behavioural changes are very important to what's going to happen with economic policy. And the committee has been asking about how we can measure some of these behavioural changes. For example, there is this question, I think John Mason referred to this, about the additional dwelling supplement, the increase from 4 to 6%. Now, that's obviously an area that can produce extra revenue, and particularly protecting first-time buyers, which is the intention of the Scottish Government. But it is an area where the behavioural change is causing other issues. So I think the scrutiny of this budget has raised quite a lot of issues about that behavioural change. The convener has rightly expressed our concerns about the timescales for public sector reform and the lack of detail that we had received on what previously had been announced by the Scottish Government, because I think it's very important that we do get some clarity on that, and Kenny Gibson's quite right to say that that is a major issue because it impacts so heavily on the Scottish budget. And I think it's interesting to note that alongside that, we've had comment from a few stakeholders about trying to extend the principle of three-year budget so that there is a bit more certainty when it comes to planning ahead, because I think many of our stakeholders want that extra ability to have a bit of certainty about how they might be able to spend
Smith,
their money.
Ms Smith, I must ask you to conclude.
I'm just on my very last line. Can I once again pay tribute to all the stakeholders who've given us that input on our scrutiny, and to the convener, and I look forward to hearing other speeches.
Thank you. I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And it's a pleasure to follow my colleague on the Finance and Public Administration Committee, and indeed to hear the contributions from everyone here today. It's really rather refreshing to hear some light rather than just heat. Many very valuable observations in the report have already been made, so I'll simply make a few additional observations. One of my biggest concerns is the flat capital budget. The Scottish Fiscal Commission points out that this is a cut in real terms of £185 million due to a lack of UK government funding and the impact of inflation. Yet I emphasise again that capital funding is vital to invest in long-term infrastructure improvements and research and development spending. Now, typically governments will borrow to invest, yet in this matter, the Scottish Government has significant restrictions where the UK Government has none. And this unbalanced devolution provides full powers to cut spending, but vastly inadequate powers to borrow to invest. One area I would like to raise is regarding the data we have on the Scottish economy. In some areas, such as inflation, we're entirely relying on ONS data for the UK. Yet in terms of understanding our economy, we also have inadequate data on the differential impacts of policy by gender, an issue the Deputy First Minister knows I continue to pursue with some vigour. In other words, if we are, as the committee has rightly called for, to see more strategic and long-term financial planning, it would be purposeful to have all the data needed to do so. Therefore, rather than focusing on measures which serve no specific policy-making purpose, such as GERS, I would welcome focus on identifying areas such as the Scottish inflation rate and how our economy serves both women as well as men. There are other areas that could benefit from additional focus. For example, in giving evidence to the committee, Professor Sir Anton Muscatelli pressed the case for serious thought to be given to ensuring that growth results in an increased tax take. And one aspect of spurring growth is to do more to encourage entrepreneurship, and in that regard, do much more to support women entrepreneurs who face structural barriers. With that in mind, I look forward with interest to the forthcoming report by Anna Stewart and the tangible government actions that I hope will arise. One final point was last week at Glasgow University's Adam Smith event in Parliament, the Deputy First Minister talked of the importance of empathy, understanding the concerns of others. Smith also wrote of the importance of the rule of law.
Now, none of these are served by the extent of corruption in the UK, where each year hundreds of billions of pounds in criminal assets are allowed to be laundered through the City of London, vastly more than the entire annual budget of the Scottish Government. Former Chancellor Nadeem Zahawi has been exposed yet again with more revelations today about his tax affairs and the threatened use of abusive lawsuits to silence Dan Needle. Even worse now, thanks to Open Democracy, we know the Treasury under Rishi Sunak helped Putin's Prigozhin when supposedly under sanctions to mount a legal targeted attack on a London journalist. There is a financial cost to corruption and a lack of ethics. It doesn't just remove money from our GDP, but ultimately results in less doctors, less teachers, less nurses, and presents a risk to Scotland's global brand for probity. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ross Grier to be followed by Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As others have said, this is by far the most difficult context in which the Scottish Government has had to set an annual budget. At this point last year, inflation was running at around 2%. The UK Government had cut the Scottish Block Grant by just over 5% in real terms, and we were rightly describing that budget as the most challenging yet in the devolution era. That feels like the good old days compared to what has transpired in the months since. Fair pay for public sector workers is now one of the biggest challenges the Scottish Government faces. To be absolutely clear, the Scottish Greens believe that all workers in the public, private and third sector deserve pay rises at least in line with inflation. But with inflation rising above 10%, a real terms budget cut from the UK Government and an extremely limited set of tax powers, it is just impossible for the Scottish Government to deliver that level of pay increase without paying for it with devastating service cuts and job losses. It would cost around £2.5 billion. That is more than twice what had to be cut in last autumn's emergency budget review. I think I'm safe in saying the Scottish Greens have the most radical tax policies of the parties in this Parliament, but even our proposals for existing taxpayers wouldn't raise close to the amount of money required. The Scottish Government has made painful decisions to fund the fairest possible pay offer to public sector workers, both to reallocate within this year's budget and in this draft budget for 23-24. But until this Parliament has the financial powers of a normal country, the only way to fund fair pay without catastrophic cuts to services is for the UK Government to either deliver pay awards to public sector workers in England, which are adequate enough to generate consequential funding for Scotland, or for them to give the Scottish Government funding to make up for the damage caused by inflation in year. The Finance Committee wants to see more forward planning from the Scottish Government. Public sector pay is an example of where some of us have sympathy for the challenges that they face, though. It's certainly not ideal for the budget to have been published without an accompanying public sector pay policy document, but it is understandable when current pay disputes haven't yet been settled. Respecting the right of unions to negotiate and demand as they see fit, to me this presents a strong case for multi-year pay settlements to become the norm for the purpose of forward planning. The relationship between tax and spend has always been a challenging one. Perfectly understandably, plenty of organisations engage with the budget process to demand additional funding for themselves, for their priorities or their sector. But very, very few groups propose where that money could come from. So I have to commend Unison for their submission to our pre-budget scrutiny, which included a range of proposed savings and tax changes. I agreed with most, but not all of them, and some are long-term reforms which couldn't be delivered in the next couple of years, but it was a credible set of progressive proposals which absolutely helped to shape the debate on tax policy last autumn. I hope the Government will respond positively to the Committee's encouragement that they revisit the previously proposed national discussion on tax. The public deserve a high quality of debate around how public money is raised and spent. But as the Convener noted, we're locked into an annual pattern of every sector just demanding more money, a bidding war which grossly oversimplifies how our public finances actually work. Worse than that, it makes it impossible for members of the public to distinguish between deliberate political choices, which they have a right to critique, and those which are the inevitable result of external factors or the limited powers available to us. Significant contributions are being made to this wider debate, such as the SDUC's tax paper published shortly before the budget. That SDUC paper is relevant to the committee's other major conclusion on tax reform around council tax, which doesn't align with the aim of a progressive tax system, nor does it give councils the flexibilities or the financial resources they need. It is a bit comical for a tax system to be based on valuations from 1992, 2 years before I was born, and I'm in my second term here. The Scottish Government and the Greens have a shared commitment to change the council tax. I look forward to seeing progress towards this during the coming financial year. I'm looking forward to what I'm sure will be a more robust and ideological debate next week, but I'm glad that we have this opportunity ahead of that to discuss issues of process and substance for which a broad consensus can be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a committee, we heard much evidence from economic experts on their views on the budget, both for this year and for future years. And I would also like to take this opportunity to thank them for their time in considering these complicated issues, and to the clerks for somehow distilling our conversations into the excellent report we are debating today. The report does flag many areas of concern that the government need to address in the coming months. But let's start with a positive. The Scottish Fiscal Commission have advised that the resource funding in the Scottish budget is set to increase by £1.7 billion, which equates to £279 million in real terms, the largest core resource block grant ever. But that, Presiding Officer, is about where the positive news ends. These are certainly challenging times. And we still have many uncertainties that are highlighted by this report. We have a devolved government who, even at this late point of financial year 22-23, has no real certainty on how this year's budget will be balanced and the impact that that will have on the 23-24 budget. And when the resource spending review was published in May 2022, we had been told that the public service reform was key to providing a balanced budget going forward. We were told that digitisation was key, public sector innovation was key, reform of public sector estate was key, and improving public procurement was key. But 9 months on, we're still no clearer when these reforms will be delivered, what they will mean for our public services, and the impact on our finances if they are not carried out. We knew they meant job reduction to pre-pandemic levels, and if we exclude health from the headcount reduction, then we can all guess where the axe will fall. Local government, yet again, the easy target for this government. Local government is under increasing pressure with this budget, and I understand that the finance directors of all 32 local authorities have written to the Finance Secretary outlining their concerns. And I often ask the Deputy First Minister at committee about the government's commitment to early intervention and prevention. And to be fair, I always get warm words back saying that it's absolutely key. But once again, when I look at this budget, I see no evidence of that. More and more of local government funding is ring-fenced, so when it comes to cuts, it will be our sports grounds that are cut, adding to obesity and a greater health bill in future years. It will be community centres closed, leading to social isolation and poorer mental health. It will be cuts to education, leading to widening attainment gap. And it will be social programmes cut, leading to increased crime and larger justice bill in the future. The short-termism is a theme that runs through the committee report, particularly when it comes to building growth and productivity in Scotland. Dr. Mike Brewer, in his evidence to the committee, described the budget as being predominantly focused on dealing with short-term challenges that are posed by the rising cost of energy and food. Mm-hmm. Professor Muscatelli also stated later in the report that the national strategic economic transformation must be pursued with vigour because it aimed at genuinely lifting business investment and productivity. And I'm concerned at the lack of focus on growth in this year's budget and that short-termism that is at its heart. Presiding Officer, in previous debates on the budget, I've said that you can tell a government's priorities by what they commit finance to. In this budget, we can only see real terms cuts. Education and skills budget cut, housing budget cut, rural affairs and island budget cut, enterprise budget cut, Police Scotland budget cut. Mm-hmm. This is a short-term budget from a short-term finance secretary for what hopefully is a government with a short-term future. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Colin Beattie, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate as Chair of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. The SCPA's main role is to scrutinise the budget proposals from Audit Scotland and its accounts. Last Friday, we published our report on Audit Scotland's budget proposal for 23-24. Unusually for the SCPA, we did not make a recommendation that the Parliament approve the total budget. Audit Scotland describes itself and its role as providing politicians, decision makers and the public with assurance and information about how public money is spent. And this is more important than ever at a time when public spending has risen sharply in response to the pressures on public services. But in the case of Audit Scotland, who audits the auditors? Who provides that scrutiny and assurance about how the public money allocated to Audit Scotland is being spent? And this is why the SCPA was established under the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act of 2000. The SCPA provides that scrutiny of Audit Scotland and in turn reports its conclusions to the Parliament. Now, by Audit Scotland, we mean the agency that provides the Auditor General for Scotland and also the Accounts Commission with the services required to carry out their respective duties. Its budget comes from two sources: fees that it charges to audited bodies and funding that comes from the Scottish Consolidated Fund and is approved by the Parliament. The SCPA met in December to consider the Audit Scotland budget proposals, specifically the £12,050,000 of Parliament-approved funding. This represented an increase in £563,000 from the previous year, and that figure could be broken down and attributed to six different factors, but I'll focus on just a few. Looking at the increase in fees and expenses paid to external audit firms who undertake work on behalf of Audit Scotland, the SCPA was keen to understand more about what was driving up costs. The budget proposal states that these fees will increase by 56% in 23-24, equating to £2.55 million. And after receiving further evidence, the SCPA noted that the previous fees were unsustainable, noted that the increase in regulations around auditing and that the fees were consistent with a costing and benchmarking exercise. In relation to fees charged to audited bodies, we sought an explanation for the variation across sectors and fee uplifts, in particular in relation to the further education section, where the average fee increase is 57.5%. Audit Scotland explained in evidence that the fees it charges audit bodies are informed by the outcome of the procurement process to appoint external audit firms. And the increase in fees is most acute in the further education sector due to the size of the organisations and the baseline costs required to deliver an audit compliant with the Code of Audit Practice. The SCPA was content with the rationale and explanations for most of the proposed increases in funding. Where we had difficulty was in understanding the rationale for a proposed £278,000 increase in support for the Accounts Commission. The Commission's function is to hold councils and other local government bodies in Scotland to account. The Commission is supported in its work by staff of Audit Scotland. We noted that the Accounts Commission had already created and was about to fill a full-time role for a controller of audit. The Commission also said it required more staff for analytical work, stakeholder engagement and providing a refreshed website. The SCPA was keen to understand the drivers and assessments for the new post and for the associated work. It was explained to us that the Accounts Commission felt that it should be making more impact and had decided to initiate a change programme. After hearing evidence and also requesting additional information, we still found ourselves in a position of not being able to reconcile the asked for budget of £278,000 with the need for that budget. We needed more substantive detail about the assessments for this work and its budget and did not feel the case had been made. We came to this position against the backdrop of the current economic outlook, cost of living crisis and the difficult choices being made in the Scottish budget and in seeking the most efficient outcomes in terms of public spending. This is a very unusual position for the SCPA to find itself in. We are required to examine the proposals from Audit Scotland.
I must ask you to conclude, Mr. Beattie.
And to report to the Parliament on them. In previous occasions, we have recommended approval of the proposals to the Parliament as part of this budget. We would simply draw the attention of the Parliament to our concerns around what we see as insufficient detail in relation to part of these proposals.
Thank you. I now call on John Swinney to wind up. Up to 8 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. May I just take a moment to reflect on Mr. Beattie's point, which I think is an important point. It's not one that I could say very much about because this is a parliamentary matter, but I think the unusual contribution, the unusual subject matter that Mr. Beattie has had to raise is something that Parliament needs to reflect on. It's not a matter for the government, but it's a matter for Parliament, which I think it needs to take very seriously indeed. Of course.
Daniel Johnson.
very grateful to him. There is a technical aspect, which is that while the Auditor General reports to Parliament, the Audit Commission is actually reports to governments. There is actually a dual role in place here, just on that technical point.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm seeking not to get hung up on that technical point. I'm saying it's quite... Mr Johnson will understand it's a rather invidious position for me to be commenting about the auditors, but I think what I'm simply pointing out to Parliament, I think it needs to take seriously what Mr Beattie has put on the record and which the SPCA has put on the record as well. Liz Smith made the most revealing comment of the whole debate, in which she said that today is the debate that we look at the substance and the scrutiny and the evidence, and next week we get into the party politics. So forgive me if I pay slightly more attention to what some colleagues say today than I will pay next week, as a little warning. Mr Mason gave some pretty sobering warnings, as he does regularly to Parliament, about the importance of the hard choices that are involved in the budget process, but also in the reconciliation of difficult questions about tax, and I welcome his support for the tax stance that I've taken. But Mr Mason's speech was followed by Douglas Lumsden, who made a strong argument for more funding for local government, but didn't offer a single scrap of evidence as to where that money was to come from. And I think that just passes the usual test from the Conservatives of empty rhetoric on some of these questions. Mr Greer, in his contribution, recognised the importance of the budget making provision, as we've had to do by adaptation and amendment in this financial year, for the challenge of public sector pay. And in relation to the concerns which I hear from members of Parliament about the fact that the government is not yet in a position to confidently set out its route to balance in this financial year, that is not for the want of trying, and it's also a measure of the scale of the difficulty and the challenge that the climate of surging inflation represents for us. There are three principal themes to the government's budget, and I want to reflect on each of those in responding to contributions. First of all, in relation to the attack on child poverty, Michelle Thompson made an important comment reflecting on the Adam Smith legacy event, that it was important to have empathy for others, to essentially walk in the shoes of others. And if anyone needed to understand that, the contribution that Natalie Dawn made to the debate this afternoon, in powerfully setting out the arguments put forward by the Social Justice and Social Security Committee and the emphasis on the sustained measures on tackling child poverty, was an important example of that empathy and the importance of understanding the challenges which her committee has done, which is to focus on the position of low-income households. It also relates to the point that Claire Baker made about the importance of sustained investment on employability, and I'm glad that we've been able to improve the resources that are available on employability in the next year's budget, despite the interim cuts I've had to make this year. On the theme of net zero, Edward Mountain set out some of the challenges that are inherent, but the necessity of making those commitments, as did Finlay Carson, on the journey towards net zero, and the government believes that we've put in place, particularly in relation to capital expenditure, the type of support that is necessary in this respect. The third principal theme of the budget is around sustainable public services, and Gillian Martin reflected on behalf of the Health and Social Care Committee on the importance of the budget settlement for the health service and the investment in social care. Audrey Nicholl, on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee, reflected on the difference in the budget settlement compared to the resource spending review, and the fact that the government has listened carefully to the challenges to ensure that we properly invest in the criminal justice system and meet its challenges. And Ariane Burgess, in relation to the local government settlement, made clear the importance of the investment that we have made and to ensure that that is sustained in the period to come. There's a couple of other contributions I wanted to reflect on just in conclusion, Presiding Officer. One is one of the points made by Siobhan Brown in relation to the COVID recovery activity. And I do want to reassure Parliament and the COVID Recovery Committee, as I did last week, of the importance we attach to mainstreaming the thinking behind the COVID recovery strategy into the government's programmes, and one of my priorities in the budget has been to do exactly that. Lastly, Claire Adamson made a very powerful point about the... very briefly.
Edward Mountain.
Sorry, I tried to catch you just before you came to your last point, Ms Swinney. My question, one of the questions that the committee was very keen on finding out is the cost as far as the carbon cost for all the decisions we're making. Are you prepared to reiterate the agreement that this will be something that the government will work to as far as getting to net zero, the actual costs of the carbon of the decision on the money that we're spending?
I think I might have to pursue that discussion with Mr Mountain in due course, because my feeling would be that what we publish in relation to the carbon assessment should fit his requirements. But if not, I'm very happy to explore that further to ensure, because I think that issue has to be resolved. I think we're doing enough in that respect, but I'll happily explore that further. Claire Adamson, presiding officer, made a really important point, which is about the disproportionate relationship between the amount of money spent on cultural investment and the impact it has on our society and our well-being. If I didn't know that point already, I wouldn't have been listening to Fiona Hislop, who for many, many years is the longest-serving culture secretary in this parliament, used to beat me into submission on budget agreements on that very argument and point, to which I pay warm tribute. But it is a really important point, and I want to assure Parliament of the sympathy I have with that point and the fact that I want to make sure we do all that we can to support investment in our cultural sector, recognising in these tough times that we're living in, people need to enjoy and appreciate the importance of cultural investment to make us who we are as a society.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Daniel Johnson to wind up the debate for up to 9 minutes, Mr Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be closing this afternoon's debate on pre-budget scrutiny on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee as the Deputy Convener. I think it has been an excellent debate, and I think it's actually a really important opportunity for us all to tie together our various committees' work and collectively focus on the priorities which undoubtedly are seen through the budget. I'd also like to pay tribute to the clerks, because as one thing that I think we can all agree from Douglas Lumsden's contribution, they do an excellent job of weaving together, I think, the multiple different lines of questioning that we provide into something that looks far more coherent and robust than perhaps the raw material might suggest. But I'd also like to thank my committee members, because I think, and as you heard in the contributions, while we may come from different perspectives, I think we actually have a very shared approach, which I think we heard in the contributions today. But that's about actually, I think, the implementation of tax policy, ensuring that it is both fair, robust and progressive, that we heard from John Mason. Looking at actually how money is spent and the impact of that spending, which I think we heard from both Convener and Michelle Thompson in terms of her contribution on data. I think one of the key focuses of this committee, especially bearing in mind our Public Administration Committee, is that the clarity that you need to have clear strategies and plans as a framework to marshal that spending. And perhaps the most important point, I think, both on an ongoing basis, but in the debate this afternoon from Quinty Metins, is the shared view that we have to have a goal of increasing prosperity in Scotland, and that ultimately that has to be one of the fundamental purposes of government that we see through the budget. I'd also just like to briefly point out that one of the more obscure points that we do cover off in part of our scrutiny is scrutinising the SPCB budget. And there's been a number of issues that we have looked at both this year and last, both look at project spending, but also issues looking at the costs that are attributed to the Parliament. And that's an important function, scrutinising the parliamentary accounts and budget proposal that our committee undertakes. Of course.
Ross Greer.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the Deputy Convener for taking intervention. On the point of the SPCB budget, I wonder if he has any thoughts, particularly around the staff cost provision provided to MSPs relative to the Parliament's wider staffing budget for the year ahead.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the member for making that contribution. I think it raises an important point. Both, I think, the point that the committee did look at, which is that the cost of inflation is well ahead of the pay settlements that are being offered across the private public sector, but that also is true of the Parliament. I am concerned about the difference between the settlement for parliamentary staff and perhaps member staff. I wonder if that might be something that we look at as a committee as part of our scrutiny in future years, and perhaps also maybe think about taking contributions from staff representatives and trade unions as part of that scrutiny. I hope that covers the point that the member raises. I'd like to thank members from various committees for their contributions, and I think there were overarching themes looking at the squeeze on the public finances and the choices that leads to, but also in terms of looking at the approaches to that. And I too would like to highlight in Claire Adamson's contribution, because I think it covered those points comprehensively. I think she highlighted very well, I think, the very real hardship and the very real difficult decisions that cultural bodies are having to face as a result of the current context. I think this was a point also highlighted by others such as Arianna Burgess, as relevant to the housing budget, and indeed also the fact that this is an issue that's facing private sector employers through the decisions that the government are making in terms of the levies that are being applied to them. This is undoubtedly a difficult time, but she also highlighted on the need for innovation to approach this. And I think that maybe alights on maybe the points that Mr Mason raises about having to have balance. We will need innovation. That will need to be looked at carefully. And I would urge committee members from across the various committees to look at actually the substance of that. Because I think while we all agree we need alternative approaches, that I think actually until we get into the detail, that becomes difficult in practice. But I think that's undoubtedly true. I think there were two particular points in terms of the approach which are particularly important and were ones that were covered off in the committee's deliberations. One was about looking at cross-portfolio impacts and preventative spend. I thought this was a point covered off excellently by both Siobhan Brown and Natalie Dawn, that if we're going to tackle poverty, it has to be done on a cross-portfolio basis. But actually also, as Claire Adamson pointed out, we need to look at the wider impacts of spend, such as cultural spend, and that is really hugely important, which is why the committee spent so much time looking at the National Performance Framework in its work. Because earlier this year we published findings of our inquiry into the National Performance Framework, Ambitions into Action, and in that and earlier reports we have recommended that there needs to be a clearer link between spending decisions in the budget and their impact on the delivery on those national outcomes. And we again repeated this recommendation in a report that we published this week. And I think at times of fiscal constraint, it can be tempting to look or discard frameworks and plans such as these, but I actually think it's in those times that plans and frameworks such as the National Performance Framework become ever more important, so that we prioritise spending on the areas that will have the most impact. And I thought that was brought to life by members very well. I mean, likewise, I think Claire Adamson and others brought to light the importance of multi-year financing and having clear patterns of funding. This was a point that we highlighted in our report on the budget, saying to the Scottish Government that it is challenging to identify in a meaningful way the individual annual impact of multiple budget lines on the delivery of longer-term, complex national outcomes. It is instead developing an approach centred around multi-year programmes and associated outcomes and the annual spend profiles attached. But we're unclear precisely what this will involve, and therefore we sought more detailed information. But it is clear from members' contribution this is very important. And I would just touch on Sue Webber's contribution, because again, the committee undertook work into the financial memorandum on delivering the 1140 hours. And I think there, I think we see clear evidence about why you need that multi-year approach, clear patterns within a framework, because otherwise actually may lead to outcomes that may be contrary to the intended. I think the reduction in the number of settings, especially in the PVI sector, is something that we should note and concern. And I think it serves as an example of why you need a robust multi-year funding and clear funding formulas. So I would also just like to highlight on Gillian Martin's contribution, because I thought Her remarks about the health budget were particularly important in bringing some of these things together, but also actually that while there may be very clear issues that the health budget is facing, and I think we're all aware of those, there is also learning and innovation to be found. And I thought her points around data, the need for more robust monitoring and evaluation, is absolutely critical if we're going to use our budget in innovative ways to deliver more in what is certainly uncertain times. And I thought that also tied in very well with what Michelle Thompson said in her contributions. So in the remaining time I've got left, I'd just like to note that we also made comments both about net zero and climate change and need for greater clarity. Our work will be ongoing in terms of looking at the work that we improve our efforts on our carbon budgeting. And I think that also touches on points that Edward Mountain raised. Capital spending remains important. We welcome the government's commitment to bringing forward the clarity in terms of COFOG. That may be a bit of a niche point for other members, but it's very important in terms of transparency. But I would also just finally like to touch on the proposals for the National Care Service, given the interest that the Finance and Public Administration Committee and many other committees represented here today will have in this. The Scottish Budget 23-24 does not specify what level of spend has been incorporated into the relevant budget line for the establishment of this new service. We therefore found it difficult to determine whether the amount allocated in next year's budget reflects the figures in the related bill's financial memorandum of between £60 and £90 million. So we welcome the Deputy First Minister's commitment to bring forward a revised financial memorandum, but we do express our concerns about that lack of clarity within the budget. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'd like to close by thanking all members for their contributions today. I look forward to next week's debate, which may have a somewhat different tenor and tone at stage one of the budget bill, and we will hear more about the Scottish Government's plans, and I'm sure we'll hear the response to that. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.